Hello everyone, hi, welcome to the channel of Wall Street Mojo. Watch the video till the end, and if you're new to this channel, then you can subscribe us by clicking the bell icon. Today we have a topic that is trade receivables, a part of balance sheet in the current asset side. Trade receivables are like, you know, your customers which have some outstanding dues. They have some outstanding dues to be paid. Why this is really important for any business? Let's learn this. If you see trade receivables over here, it's 4.66 billion over here and 1.48. It's for Colgate, that's in blue, 1.48, and Procter and Gamble, close to 4 billion. So what exactly is the difference here? Okay, let's understand this. See, trade receivable is an accounting entry in the balance sheet of, so which arises due to, you know, selling of the goods and services by the entity to its customers on a credit basis. So since this is an amount which the entity has a legal claim, you know, over its customers, and also the customer is bound to pay same to the entity, it is classified as the current assets in the balance sheet of the entity. So the trade receivable and the account receivables are used interchangeably in the industry. Now, similar to the account receivable, company also have the non-trade receivables which arises on account of the transactions unrelated to the regular course of the business. Okay, now trade receivables on the balance sheet end, let's talk about that. The standard format of the balance sheet of an enterprise, let me show you that. This is the standard format of Colgate. You know, you see the asset side on the trade receivable, there is in current assets, there is cash, then there is receivable net of allowances of 77 and 73 respectively. Then they have inventories, other current assets, total current assets, and then all the tangible part starts. So what exactly this is all about? Let's discuss. Now see, this is generally classified under the current assets in the balance sheets, right? We'll take an example here to understand this in a more conceptual manner. Let's say there is a company called ABC Corporation in an electrical equipment manufacturing company. So it has recorded its sales, let's say at 100 US billion dollars of financial 18, with let's say, and 30% of the sales on credit, 30% of sales is on credit to its corporate customers. So the trade receivables accounting entry for the transaction is the balance sheet will be shown something like this. The total sales of financial year 18 is going to be how much? 100 billion. So everything will be in terms of billion. Then there'll be credit sales, 30%. We have account receivables and trade receivables. That will be, let's say, total sales as a percentage of sale on basically credit. And then you have account receivable and trade receivables as 100%, 100, yeah, that is 100 billion into 30%. Right. So that comes down to how much? USD, $30 billion. So that is the amount of the credit sales. And as an account receivable, it will be shown in the balance. So in this example, the account receivable recorded is at $30 billion in the current asset, in the current assets head in the balance sheet. Now, why the trade receivable is a very, you can say, a critical aspect. I want to understand this, why exactly this is critical. See, I'll try to demonstrate that why account receivables are very critical for the liquidity of the company. And many times it becomes a very sole reason for the company is becoming bankrupt. So the liquidity analysis of the enterprise comprises of company short-term financial positions, right, and ability to pay its short liabilities. So one of the most important metric we look at while analyzing the liquidity position of the company is the cash conversion cycle. And cash conversion cycle is the, you know, number of days which an enterprise takes to convert its inventory into cash. Okay, so it's something like this. You have inventory over here, then you do a sale, so you get trade receivables, because some won't be receivables, some will be, like, you know, on a credit basis. For the same trade receivable, you get cash here, and finally that cash that you need to pay to the accounts payable, that is to the supplier. So this is the whole chain of the whole cycle, you can say that, right? So the above, this thing, you know, inventory, trade receivable, cash, AP, it explains in a way, it's the inventory cycle. So for an enterprise, it starts with the purchase of the inventory from the AP, Right, which may be on cash or credit purchase. The enterprise converts that into finished goods, okay, and makes sales out of it. The sale are made for cash and credit. The sales made on the credit is recorded as trade receivables. So the cash conversion cycle is the total number of the days it takes for an enterprise to convert its inventory to finished goods and then to make a final sales with trade receivables, and the total number of days it takes the enterprise to convert its inventory into final sales and realization of the cash. So the formula of the cash conversion cycle, CCC, it's triple C, days receivable plus days of inventory less days payable outstanding. So from the above formula, it is evident, you know, that the company with a significantly higher proportion of trade receivable will have higher days of receivables and therefore higher cash conversion cycle. Now what you need to note that, of course, you know, the CC triple C depends on the other two factors also, which are days of inventory outstanding and days payable outstanding. However, here to explain the impact of the receivables, we have kept other two parameters indifferent. So you can say the higher cash conversion cycle for an enterprise may lead to a significant increase in the working capital. And once the trade receivables have level reaches the alarming level, it may create a serious trouble for the enterprise, creating, you know, a short-term liquidity issues, which company will not be able to fund its short-term liabilities, which may be further lead to suspending operations of the company. So this can lead. This can happen, absolutely happen. Now, trade receivable as an important part of the working capital loan assess. So a company avails the working capital, WC, loans to meet its short-term requirement for, you know, day-to-day operations. So the assessment for the amount of the working capital, you know, limit is carried out by the lenders, taking into account all the current assets of the company. And since the receivables make the important and considerable part of the total current assets and company, it is critical for the lenders to assess the level of trade receivables as well, you know, all the quality of the receivables to approve working capital limits for the company. Now, let me run you through the trade receivables analysis part and interpretation part. Let me run you through that. See, the liquidity analysis and interpretation for the level of the trade receivable should always be looked in the context of some specific industry. Okay. Now, there are certain industry which operates in an environment with, you know, a high level of receivables. So a typical example of same is like, you know, electricity, what we call as generation companies operating in India, where receivables level are very high and days receivables for generation companies are varies between as low as, you know, 1 month to as high as closely to 9 months. Okay, so on the other hand, there are companies which operate which work with virtually very less or no trade receivables. So companies that are operating and roll road projects, developer and operator have very fewer accounts receivables, as the revenue is toll collection from the computers or commuters on the road, and they collect the toll from the commuters as when they pass by the toll plaza. So for a meaningful analysis, one should look at the trade receivables levels of the top four or five companies in a respective industry. And if your target company has, you know, let's say higher receivables other than the four companies in the same industry, then the company is doing something wrong, either in the term of the business model or the client or the customers are targeting or incentive in terms of the credit sales. So to conclude, one can safely assume that lower the trade receivable levels and days receivables is better the liquidity position. So that's it for this particular topic. If you have learned and, you know, liked the video, if you think that, you know, if you have enjoyed and learned watching this video, please like, comment on this video and subscribe to our channel for all the latest updates. Thank you, everyone. Cheers.